isn't it good to have Tim here this morning?
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Number two, isn't it great to have God here this morning? Okay, I love Tim, but I don't love him as much God. All right? So, isn't it great to have God here this morning? For those of you who might be visiting with us, I don't quite often get this carried away to start a service with, but you'll find out later in the sermon, all right, why I'm doing this. Here's what I want you to do. How many of you love the San Francisco Giants? Let me hear from you. You're Giants fans. Woo! How many of you are Dodger fans? Okay. All right. How many of you are fans of Jesus Christ? Woo! All right, let's hear it. All right. All that's going to make sense in a little while, all right? But welcome to New Hope Church today. It's great to have you here. It is a special day for us. Let me tell you part of what makes today special. Because I get to tell you that last Sunday on Father's Day, we had 37 more people in Father's Day services than we had in Mother's Day services this year. First time ever in my life as a pastor that Father's Day outdid Mother's Day. So great job, men. Way to go. All right. Ladies, the gauntlet has been thrown down for next year. All right. It is thrown down. If you are a guest today, it's your first time at New Hope, we are so delighted you're here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by, and next week through the mail, we'll give you information that tells you about our church family. We always make a promise not to beat on your door or pester you on the phone, but through the mail, try to give you as much information to answer as many questions as we possibly can. Those cards are also there for our church family. If you've got messages to the staff or prayer requests or updates, please take the opportunity to fill those out and put them in the offering as they come by. So I don't forget, there is a VBS Leaders Kickoff meeting today, about 10 minutes after the last service is over. Hopefully that will be about 12:15, all right? So if you are one of the VBS volunteers, it would be great for you to go have a quick breakfast after you leave here and then come back for that kickoff meeting at around 12:15 today. And is that going to be here in the sanctuary? Do we know where that meeting is going to be? It's going to be in the bridge. Thank you very much. It will be in the bridge, all right? And that's the building straight through those double doors right across the pavilion, all right? Speaking of Vacation Bible School, it starts tomorrow night. Have you noticed anything different on the stage? That is in preparation for tomorrow night. Their theme is Cave Quest, Following Jesus, the Light of the World. And Mark Addis and a couple of his staff where he works... All right, they put that together.
Well, they said go left at the boulder that looked like a nose, go right at the pond that smells like old socks, and that means I should be... No, no, this is useless. It is not the right place.
Hello.
Oh, hello.
I'm Corey, and these are my friends. Can we help you?
Hi, I'm Clark. Clark Cavern of the... Caving Technical Institute. I'm a sophomore there.
Oh, nice. Oh, let me help you
sorry.
That. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
What is all of this stuff?
Well, you know, despite my professional appearance, I need all this gear to get through the cave. So I've got ropes and harnesses in case I need to rescue someone. I've got flashlights so I can see in the dark. I've got maps so I know where I'm going, and the best caving books. In case I forget something.
What is this?
This is a caving device of my own design.
Clark, it's a toilet plunger.
No, very humorous. This actually is a personal fall stopper.
A personal fall stopper?
Yes. Okay. Imagine this. Okay. You are slunking your way through a cave, and it's slippery. Then you slip. Oh! But instead of sliding off down the slope and breaking your hat, into further danger, you deploy your personal fall stopper, and you're safe and sound.
Wow, I am impressed. You seem to know a lot when it comes to all this caving stuff.
Well, you know, I've wanted to be a professional caver since I was little. But honestly, the harder I try... I just.
What's wrong?
I'm a terrible caver. I just can't do anything I'm terrible in all the tests that I have to take in class. It's hopeless. I'm never going to be a caver. And you're right. This is just a toilet plunger. I got it at my mom's house. That's great.
Yes.
Maybe this week isn't going to be as bad as I thought.
Not at all.
That's great. I might be overprepared, though. Do you need an extra plunger?
I'm good, thank you.
Are you sure? Well, yourself.
All right.
I better get to camp.
Okay, please come back and visit us tomorrow.
All right, I wouldn't want my teachers to have to send out another search party.
All right, no search party. We'll
okay, thank you very much. Oh, yeah, I need those. Oh, my map. I might have too much stuff.
Maybe, but.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right.
Bye.
Well, that's what our kids are in store for all week next week, all right? So if you would like to come and be a part of that, that starts tomorrow evening. All the information is here. If you have children or grandchildren and you have not signed them up yet for Vacation Bible School, you can do that right after the service, all right, outside here today. Or you can show up a little bit early tomorrow evening and get them signed up. If your kids are already signed up, please go out here. I believe they can pick up their T-shirts already, all right? For those who've already signed up, they can pick their T-shirts up today. So please take note of that. Looks like it's going to be a great week up there. And didn't Mark do a great job on this set? Wow. Woo. Steven Spielberg, eat your heart out. All right. Ladies, not too late for you to get your tickets to the Giggles and Goodies Night. See Fawn Boss, all right? She's got tickets for that. It's coming up August 6th. Don't wait to the last minute. They might sell out, really, literally. So see Fawn and get those picked up because we're going to be inviting another church or two to come join us on that special night. If you didn't bring your baby bottles back last week, you should have brought them back this week. If you didn't bring them back today, get them by the office tomorrow or Tuesday at the latest because they will be picking them up midweek, all right? So those of you who have the bottle, you know all about that. World Changers, thank you. You filled up all of the spots for providing lunch for our two groups of World Changers this coming week. It's Tuesday through Friday. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, office staff, they will get a call. They should have, all right, the day before. So the Tuesday people, you'll get a call Monday reminding you what you're to bring and what time you're to drop it off. So they should get all those reminders out a day in advance. It does need to be here by 10:30 so that it can be picked up and delivered starting at 11:30. Homeless Outreach is going to be Sunday, July the 3rd. That's next Sunday. They will be serving at the Rescue Mission. And so read the details in your bulletin, and you can contact the Blanket Ships for more information. But they would love to have you come and participate in that. If you see the Denhartogs as you leave service and as they're coming for the next one, wish them happy anniversary. It is their 60th anniversary. You got to be old to be married 60 years. We got some who've been married longer than that, all right, sitting right back there. But they had their celebration last night, so extend to them a happy anniversary. Milo is not with us today. He had some medical tests done on Friday, but why don't you blow up his phone today? Not because he had medical tests, but because today is his birthday, all right? So wish Milo, our worship leader here, happy birthday today, and trust that everything came out okay. Yeah, it has something to do with the test. Yeah, that would crack him up. Do you need his phone number? I can. Okay, I'll give you his number so you can blow up his text. All right, here we go. I'm going to give it to you. I did it in the last service, so if you want to just blow his phone up right now, you can do that. I'm going to give it to you. He's going to love this, huh? Isn't he? Randy's laughing at me over here. That's the one time you can use your church, your phone in church. Right now, you can do that, all right? Then turn them off, turn them on silent, all right? Good. Let me bring you a couple of updates on some prayer requests, and then we'll get engaged in our worship today. The Bill Richardson family, Bill is a lover of Jesus. He's related to Diane Fletcher from our church, and he passed away this past week. And I'm your uncle, all right? Yeah, and I met with all the kids and his wife on Friday, and so Please be praying for them and God's best and care. That service is going to be Friday out at Sanger. Eileen Martin Mezgedian had her service this past Thursday. She also knew Christ, and we're grateful for that. She went to the doctor for her 70-year-old checkup, got a clean bill of health. She was doing well, and 6 days later, she died. And here's what we learned from that. This is a reminder. Death may catch us by surprise, but it doesn't have to catch us unprepared. Okay? And we love doctors, and we love all that they're able to do, but they are not the guardians of our life and our death. As we learned last week in Psalm chapter 9, it is God who determines, okay, when we return to dust from which we came. That's His call. So we do the best we can with what man is able to do at God's provision, and then we trust Him for the rest. So it was a good reminder for that. So those are just a couple of updates besides what's in your bulletin. Continue to pray for Angela Monroy's mom. She is out of the hospital and she is in a rehab facility. And so continue to pray for her recovery. It's very slow. It's very gradual. But we are grateful for those improvements. And please continue to remember them as you pray. Our Uganda team, they are doing good in Africa. All right. I get my updates about every day from one or two of them. And they are just doing well. Dennis, you don't look like you've lost any weight since Don's been gone, so you're eating okay? You're doing fine. All right, that's good. Don is one of the six that we have in Uganda. They did a vacation Bible school the other day for 200 kids. They did a home makeover, all right, a hut in a village for an elderly woman. They repaired the roof. They poured a cement foundation for the hut to be around. And they did the cement thing because that helps keeps the rats and mice out that come in during the night and nibble on your toes. Okay? We heard that story from Mike in Ivory Coast, Africa. That story also is true in Uganda. All right? And so that lady was very, very happy. Now, some of you are never going to go with me to Africa now, huh, because I told that story. By the way, Mike Cousineau will be with us the last Sunday of July, and we'll be looking for folks who want to go with us next February. It might be my final trip. It's the final one of my commitment that I made when I said I'm going 5 years ago. This will be trip number 5, and I'd love to have 10, all right, go with us. To Ivory Coast next February. So that will be the end of the month. That wraps up, I think, all the things I need to share with you today. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Hey, look, there's Clark. There's Clark. All right. Let's pray. It's great to have Donna Walters back there, all right, in her spot. Continue to pray for Donna and her back issues. They're still trying to get that figured out, but great to have Donna back with us today. Let's pray. Father, for the life that you offer to share with us, you're always a perfect gentleman with your offer. You never force us or make us share life with you, but you make yourself available to us 24/7. And you share with us whatever portion of that 24/7 we're willing to share with you. Dear Father, I'm so grateful that we have the opportunity to be together today, to share life, to share worship, to share needs and concerns, to share encouragement and hope, to share joys and praise. And Father, I trust that that today we'll give you all of that and we won't hold anything back. Father, I trust you with the needs that we've mentioned and other needs which, Father, you are so well aware of and in tune with that we haven't mentioned but are important to us. We trust you. We know that your strength is sufficient. We know that your hope is more than enough to overcome our grief and our sorrow and our uncertainty. We know that your peace is what gets us through uncertain times. And so we simply say thank you in advance for knowing that you'll provide for us in the future as you have in the past. Dear Lord, for our church family that's in Uganda, though they are so far from us, you are not far from them. You are right there in their midst doing in and through them in Uganda what you do in and through them right here, communicating your love, your life, and your truth to those who need to hear it. Father, for those who've come here maybe with a bit of uncertainty, I pray that today that they will find the answers they need from the one who is not uncertain. The one who the Scripture says is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And Father, it's in that name of the one who is the same in the past, in the present, and in the future that we have a right and a privilege to pray. It's the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus. And it's in that name we bring our gifts and our tithes and our offerings to you today, Father. Not only as an act of worship, not only as an act of obedience, but as an act of joy. For your word says you love those who give hilariously, cheerfully. And so we do so today. We give you tribute and honor with our lives, with our talents, with our gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. Great job today. Hey, it's great to see our drummer over there can play with both hands, all right? If you remember, he was with us at Christmas time, and we had a little problem with our drum set, and he got to play with one hand, but good job. Great job today. I invite you to take your Bibles, if you would, and find in the Old Testament hymn book of Psalms, Psalm 95. For those of you who are visiting with us today, or if maybe you've missed a few weeks and you forgot the series we're in called The Less, More Lifestyle, we've started putting in the program, all right, a summary, a quick summary. So either after the service or if you get bored during this sermon, you can kind of go check out, all right, why we're doing this. But this is about what areas of my life do I need less of me so there is more of Christ at work? And there's four key steps to that, and that's what's mentioned there. And we're choosing the book of Psalms to be in all year because the Psalms lend themselves to step four, which is teaching us how to be more contemplative, how to be men and women and young people who, when we think about the Scriptures, we don't rush, we don't hurry, but we slowly think about what does that mean and what does that mean for me. And so today we're going to be in Psalm 95. Psalm 95 starts with one four-letter word, come. There are those, there's a great outline that I'm not going to use today, but I'm just going to throw it out there, all right, because it's really a good outline, all right? We can break this down into four key thoughts. One, Psalm 95 is an imperative invitation. This is not really an invitation that that you have a choice of how you want to RSVP. This invitation is imperative. You're supposed to say yes. No's are really not acceptable. This is more of a command than it is a request. You know, sometimes we say to folks, hey, why don't you come over for dinner? That's a request. On occasions, my mother would call up even after I was a grown man and married, and she would say, you're coming to my house to dinner tonight. The tone of the voice told me whether that was a request or a command. The tone of this passage is this is not a request, this is a command. It's an imperative invitation. Number two, it's an inclusive participation. Nobody was to be left out. When Mama said, the family's coming to supper, everybody was supposed to participate. God is doing the same thing here. Then there is an impressionable exaltation. I think today we had an impressionable exaltation in our worship, didn't we? Worship team did a great job, all right? As we engage together, inclusive participation, there should be an impressionable exaltation. And the reason for all of that is because we have an imperishable reason. Jesus Christ saved us from our sins, has removed the guilt and condemnation from our lives. He offers to us a home in heaven and we die. And between now and then, His unending presence in and through us for everything that we face every day that we live on earth. That's a pretty good reason to worship Him, isn't it? Now, that's not a bad outline. That's just a little extra, all right? I want to focus more on a couple of other things, and I want to start with that opening line, the opening word, come. It might be only one word, but it's a very important word. It's an extremely powerful word in this context. We are being summoned, kind of like when the court system might send you something in the mail that says, you are summoned to jury duty. You can say no, but it's usually costly when you do. Okay. God is saying, come. You can say no, but it's probably going to be costly if you do. This summons is given three times in this one psalm. In verse 1, it says, come, let us sing. In verse 2, it says, come, let us before Him with thanksgiving. And in verse 6, we read, come, let us bow down in worship. This idea of worship is not something that is optional for God's children. Rather, it is something that is specifically requested of them. I will even go so far as to say it is required of us. This summons is significant because it shows that we are not to worship God on our terms. We are to worship Him on His terms. He does not come to us for worship. We are to come to Him for worship. There were two young boys who were walking down a street in downtown Minneapolis when out from an alley ran a Rottweiler that attacked one of the boys. The other boy saw a 2x4 lying there on the street of the alley. He picked it up and he beat the dog in submission and he saved his friend's life. A reporter from the Minneapolis Star Tribune got wind of what had happened and requested an interview from the first boy. He ran the story on the front page and the headline read, Vikings fan bravely saves friend's life from rabid Rottweiler. The boy called the reporter and said, I'm not a Vikings fan. The reporter said, oh, I just thought since you were from Minneapolis, you were probably a Vikings fan. I'll correct the mistake in tomorrow's paper. The next day, the correction read, Timberwolves fan bravely saves friend's life from rabid Rottweiler. The boy called the reporter again and said, I'm not a Timberwolves fan. The reporter said, well, are you some kind of sports fan? And the young man said, yes, in fact, I am a die-hard Green Bay Packers fan. The reporter agreed to note the change in the next day's newspaper. The next day, the correction read, Redneck idiot kills faithful family pet. Obviously, there was a bias in that reporter's viewpoint, and he expressed it, all right, in the article. Well, just like that illustrates, everyone's take and viewpoint on worship can be very, very different. Ask a Pentecostal and then ask an Anglican. Ask an Episcopalian and then a Catholic. Ask a Wesleyan, a Methodist. Ask a younger person or an older person. Ask somebody from our 8 o'clock service and somebody from our 9:15 service. Ask somebody on this side of the sanctuary. Ask somebody on this side of the sanctuary. You will probably come away with as many different views as the number of people that you ask about the subject. However, I want to stress what I believe is an exceedingly important point today. I run a risk in making this point of making a lot of you angry. It's a risk I'm willing to take. Here's the point I want you to understand at the outset of jumping into this psalm. I want to make the point this morning that your take or my take on worship is quite frankly irrelevant. Your view and my view about the subject of worship is really irrelevant. For it is only God's viewpoint on worship that really should matter to us. That was a real hearty amen, wasn't it, from the crowd? Very few, if any, of the differences in viewpoint that would have been given by any of the people that we could interview really has nothing to do with the theology of worship. It has to do with personal preference. Most of us probably have a high degree of agreement on what it means theologically to worship God, but we may differ greatly when it comes to style. The good news is that nowhere in the Scripture does God prescribe a particular style as the right one, including yours or mine. As I thought about this in preparation for today, I was reminded what this psalm says. Come! God longs for us to enter into His presence. He's not concerned about laying down a lot of rules and regulations. Instead, according to John 4:23, God tells us He has two primary requirements in seeking worshipers who will adore Him. And those two requirements are that we worship Him in His Spirit and we worship Him by His truth. Those two are the essentials. He sends a summons out to each of us, not an invitation, a summons. He wants us to come without hesitation into his very presence. I want us to see this psalm in three different parts of God's summons to worship. In verses 1 through 5, we will look at the call to worship, the call to rejoice in worship. In verses 6 and the first part of 7, we will look at the call or the summons to reverence in our worship. And number 3, in verses the latter part of verse 7 through the concluding verse, verse 11, we will look at a call or a summons to respond because of worship. So let's jump in and look at verses 1 through 5. It says, "Come, let us sing for the joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation." The rock. Notice in your Bible, that's a capital R. It's not a little R, because this is a title given to God. He is the rock. That meant a lot to the Hebrews, who understood some things about rocks out in their wilderness wandering. A rock is abiding. It is immutable. It is mighty. We find our deliverance and our security at the rock. The rock was also the place where that they could build a fortress out of the rock, and the rock was also the place that they could speak or smite the rock, and water would come out of it. It was their sufficiency. It was also a place where often God made covenants with his people. It goes on, "Let us," second time, "let us come before him with thanksgiving. Let's extol him with" what? "Music and song." Extol, what does that mean? It means get loud. It means this isn't something that's supposed to be just necessarily quiet and private. And I know a lot of people, you know, my worship is really a very private thing with me. It should be, but it should not be the only way in which you worship him. It says extol. That's that again, not an optional thing. And he says how to do it: with music and song. "For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land." In these couple of verses, this passage gives us at least five characteristics of worship. Just at least five. First of all, worship is collective. Notice that three times in verses 1 and 2, it says, "Let us, let us, let us." While worship should have a private element in our hearts throughout the week, the psalmist is stating that worship is designed to be congregational, not individual. I have people over the years who tell me, "Pastor, I would love to come to church, and you know what I do? I do it from my lazy boy in front of the TV. I watch Charles Stanley." Charles Stanley's good. One of the finest preachers that ever lived. Probably after I say this, none of you will ever say that to me again. Here's the deal. You really ain't worshiping. The vast majority of the time, it's convenient. Okay? It's convenient. You're not coming, you're not following this admonition, "Let us do this thing together." It's the admonition in the New Testament: don't forsake the assembling, the congregational aspect of what it means to be part of God's family. Number two, not only is it collective, but it is to be vocal. Too often we think of worship as private and also silent. We may worship God in our hearts, and we might even sing quietly, but God is longing for us to sing out to him. How about using the same enthusiasm in our worship as the Cleveland fans did last Sunday night? Okay, I heard Fawn say that she heard her husband yell louder than she's ever heard him after they won the other night. I cried that loud. But why can't there be that same kind of enthusiasm? You see, worship number three is to be vibrant and vigorous. This passage tells us we are to participate with joyful, grateful praise, to be exuberant in our worship. Someone has said that the characteristic note of Old Testament worship is exhilaration. The terms employed here describe activity, which seems more appropriate at a Fresno State football game than it does inside a church sanctuary. The phrase "sing for joy" can be translated "shout for joy." When we are told later in the next verse, "shout aloud," the Hebrew literally means "raise a shout, get your voice up." This was done when the Israelites were anticipating a battle or they were celebrating a triumph. This expression was used in Joshua chapter 6, verse 20. You don't have to turn there. I'll just highlight it for you. When the Israelites entered the land of promise, the first place they came to was a city called Jericho. And they were told, if you want to win the battle at Jericho, walk around the city once a day for 6 days, and on the seventh day, walk around it 7 times. And at the end of the seventh time, I want you to give a shout, and the walls will come tumbling down. Let me ask you a question. When you think on the seventh day, and they got to the seventh time, how do you think they sounded? Fall. I don't think that. The trumpets blew and the voices shouted. They were excited and it made the walls come tumbling down. I don't really know why our worship, my worship, is not as vibrant and vigorous as we often see in the Old Testament. I don't know why sometimes it's so somber. Maybe it's a cultural thing, or maybe we've gotten in a rut, or maybe, you know what, we're just being rebellious and not very expressive. Or maybe it's because we don't have much joy in our heart. I'm not sure of all the reasons, but I have personally been challenged by the psalm to be more exuberant and expressive in worship. Why is it that we're often critical of others, of those who worship is more animated or enthusiastic than ours? While there are extremes, I would agree that we probably should avoid, very few of us ever come close to being too passionate in our worship. Our tendency is to react against such things. Back up a little bit. We are much like Michal, the daughter of Saul, who was very unhappy with David's joyful enthusiasm in 2 Samuel chapter 6. We find in verse 12 there that when David brought the Ark of the Covenant into the city of Jerusalem, David brought it in with great rejoicing. Verse 14 tells us that he danced before the Lord with all of his might. You got to remember, I grew up in a Baptist church. I never saw one Baptist dance in church. Not once. But David did. And was it just a little subtle thing? It says, with all his might. Verse 15 says, his worship was filled with shouts and sounds of trumpet, much like it was at Jericho. When Michal, Saul's daughter, saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord, verse 16 says, she despised him in her heart. David responded to her despising him by saying he was focused only on the Lord when he was expressing himself in worship. In the last part of verse 21, he says, I will celebrate before the Lord. David didn't care how he looked to others because he was intent on fully engaging himself in wholehearted worship. And so we are to collectively express ourselves vocally with vibrancy and exuberance. When we sing songs of praise, we should shout an incredible volume level out of joyful gratitude for the rock of our salvation. As Oswald Chambers, the writer of My Utmost for His Highest devotional book, says it, a joyful spirit is the nature of God in my blood. When God Himself so penetrates our life that we are consumed by a desire to worship Him, we can't help but break out in joyful praise. Most of you know I was raised Baptist. I was in my 50s before I ever got my hands out of my pocket in a worship service. And it started kind of like this. I finally got to hear. And on occasions, I got to hear. Only in the last year or so did I get my left hand out of my pocket. And only in the last few years do I mind not standing when I haven't been asked to stand in church. And here's the policy, or the lack of policy, at New Hope. You can stand when you want to and you can sit when you want to. If Tim or Milo says stand and you don't want to stand, you don't have to stand. But if somebody hasn't told you to stand during worship, you could stand. Okay? It's okay. And it's okay to stand alone. Okay? Tim is a different story. Okay? He's 6'6", all right? So, no. Tim stands out no matter where he is. Tim stands out when he's seated. Okay? But did it make any difference? But we got to get past a little bit of this of, I wonder what somebody's going to think. This says, come to him, not come for each other. Pretty important. Fourth thing, God, worship is God-centered. This is a good reminder because we are not to do exuberant worship so it makes us feel better. That's not the reason we do exuberant. We do exuberant worship because God is in our blood and we want to honor him. Our focus should not be on how worship makes us feel. Our worship must be centered on the truth of who God is. Notice these first two verses. Sing for joy to the Lord. Shout to the rock of our salvation. We must make sure our worship is Christ-centered, not man-centered. I love that song, I Am. That is as Christ-centered as you can have any song be. You and I must be engaged in a total preoccupation with the rock of our salvation. Number five, worship is founded on truth. On truth. For the Lord is the great God, the King above all gods. John Piper, pastor and author, puts it this way, we also believe that our joy shows the supremacy of God's value to us. If His greatness is the basis of our joy, then our joy should be the evidence of His greatness. By the way in which we celebrate and worship God, would anybody know how great our God is? Ooh, I think that would be words to a song we should sing. Okay, four of you know that's a song we sing. Okay, good. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. Let me say that one again because that's really good. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. If we are not joyful, if we don't respond to the first call to rejoice, then we are not giving evidence of God's greatness. Our collective, vocal, vibrant, God-centered rejoicing must be founded on the truth of who He is and what He's done. And the psalmist, by the voice of God, calls all of us, summons all of us to come and rejoice in awesome transcendence of who God is. That's the call to rejoice. Next is the call to reverence. Verse 6, first part of verse 7, gives us the second invitation to worship. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture. We are the flock under His care. As we sang earlier in our service, blessed be your name, placing our trust in the one who is able. Notice the change of tone from enthusiastic, loud song of joy to awe-inspired reverence and humility before God as we moved into how great thou art. You see, we are called to move from praise to prostration. In verses 1 and 2, the worshiper stands in God's presence, shouting forth His praises. But now in verse 6, we are to be worshipers who fall on our face before God in humbled quietness. Worship involves both animated rejoicing and speechless reverence. Not only has the mood of this psalm changed, but so has the focus. It is now no longer just God, our Creator, who is in our view, but it is rather God who is our Redeemer and our Savior. We are the flock that's under His care. We are the people in His pasture. God is our loving shepherd who pays close attention to each of us personally. This should cause us to bow down and worship and kneel before the Lord our Maker. Bowing and kneeling helps us get humbled before God, which is the essence of worship. We accept our place before Him while acknowledging His place above us. It's interesting that the call for rejoicing is primarily based upon God's sovereignty as Creator, and that the call for reverence is now based upon our relationship. We often think it should be the other way around, that we rejoice over our relationship and we stand in awe of His mighty deeds in creation. And then it hit me this week, the deeper our relationship with God is, the more profound our sense of awe and reverence. It's about relationship, folks. when I first married Shelley, I was in awe. She was beautiful. She was so gracious to me. But there's a sense now, 8 years later, not because of physical appearance or just personal character, but there is a sense of awe and wonder because the 8 years of marriage have been. It's no longer based on who she is in and of herself. It's based on who I am, context of relationship with her. And I believe that's part of the principle in a relationship with God. We often want to think we're in awe and wonder because He is the Creator, but we should end up being in awe and wonder because He is my Savior. The fact that He was the Creator doesn't do one thing for my sinful nature. But the fact that He has loved me in spite of my sin and redeemed me out of it, that should put awe in our lives. And if we don't have that kind of intimacy, we will not have that kind of awe and wonder. Before we move to the final part of God's invitation, I want to make the point that our corporate worship together should always contain elements of both expressive rejoicing and contemplative reverence. Last part of the psalm, a call to respond. I see the last part of verse 7 as a transition. It says, "Today, if you hear His voice." On the one hand, it serves to conclude the first part of the psalm. At the same time, it serves as an introduction to the final call of a summons, the summons to respond. The Message translation of the Bible puts it this way: hey, drop everything you're doing and listen. Listen as God speaks and do not turn a deaf ear to Him. Let me make two general observations as we look at verses 8 through 11. First, there's another dramatic change of mood here. From the jubilant praise of the opening verses to the call of reverence in verse 6, we now come to a solemn warning. And this warning should not be taken lightly. Second, there is a change of speakers. In the first 7 verses, the psalmist has spoken. Now in these last couple of verses, we will hear directly from God Himself as He warns us against the dangers of a hard heart. There's a warning here that you and I should take very seriously if we are not careful. And it's connected, I believe, to our perspective, attitude, and action of worship. If we are not engaged in responding to His summons to worship Him, there is the danger for us to develop a hard heart. Let's read verses 8 through 11. "Do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massa in the desert." Meribah and Massa probably mean nothing to you, but hang on. I hope it'll make sense in a moment. "This is where your fathers tested and tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years I was angry with that generation, and I said, 'There are people whose hearts go astray. They have not known my ways.' So I declared an oath in my anger, 'They shall never enter my rest.'" They shall never enter my rest. That jumps loudly at me. God says there is a potential, if you do not respond to my summons to be engaged in worship, that your heart will grow hard. And when it does, when it grows so hard, you'll never know my rest. They never got to go into the promised land. That was part of the issue of them in the Old Testament. For us today, Jesus sends an invitation. Isn't this interesting? Hundreds of years after this was written, a couple thousand years probably, Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who are tired and weary and beaten down." And what will He provide for us? Rest for our souls. God, the Creator and the Redeemer, longs to give your and my weary life rest. But He gives us a warning here. As much as I want to give you rest, if you do not respond to my summons, your heart will grow hard and you'll never get my rest. Essentially, what God wants in worship is this, that we would listen to His voice. More than just coming together to sing, he wants us to walk away from here living what we hear. That's why we look at our entire service as corporate worship, not just singing time, but praying and worshiping and listening to his voice and hearing from the scriptures. God warns us against the danger of a hard heart, and he does this with a couple of illustrations from Israel's history. Specifically, God is referring to what happened when the children of Israel escaped Egypt and they failed the first time around to get the land of Canaan. Massah and Meribah are not just geographical location names, though they are places. But they also designate two evils that the children of Israel were very familiar with. Both characterize the conduct of God's people who had hardened their hearts. Massah is a Hebrew word for test. Meribah is derived from the word for strife and contention. Let's refresh our memories or maybe share with you for the very first time. If you were to go back in your Bible, write these down, read them later. There are two passages. First one is Exodus 17. It mentions the first instance of Massah and Meribah. God had recently delivered his people from bondage in Egypt. He had parted the Red Sea for them. In chapter 15, the people sang a song of praise to God for his redemption. When the Israelites thirsted, by Exodus 17, they began to grumble. And they began to grumble at Marah. God sweetened their water, and at Marah he gave them both bread and meat. In chapter 17, the people began to quarrel with Moses because they had run out of water again. Now, wouldn't you think if God had gotten them out of Egypt, if this God who parted the Red Sea, if this God who in the desert already gave them water and food, that he's not going to let them down a few days later? And they start whining, grumbling, complaining, and getting all over Moses, all right? They're really lashing out on him. And Moses told them they were grumbling against God, not him. And do you know what they threatened to do to Moses? They threatened to stone him. It might be from here where we get the idea, hey, don't kill the messenger. Moses said, I'm just telling you what God has to say about all this. God then instructed Moses, strike the rock with his rod, and water gushed out, and the people were able to drink. And they named the place, which was Marah. They named the place now Massah and Meribah because the people had grumbled and tested God. The second account of this terminology is found in Numbers chapter 20. Here only the term Meribah is used. The event is similar to the one in Exodus, but this one happened nearly 40 years later when the people, because of their rebellion the first time, didn't inherit the land. They're back about ready to enter in. And the people are grumbling and complaining. The kids didn't learn a lot from the parents. Moses and Aaron now fall on their face before God, and God's glory appears to them. And God instructs Moses to speak to the rock so that water will come out. So instead of obeying God and following the directions, Moses scolded the people, and he did what he had done before. Be careful about doing what you've done before. God may give you a new direction. And this time, he hits the rock twice. Last time he hit it once, but what was he told to do? Speak to the rock. Talk to the rock is what he was supposed to do. And he didn't do that. God indicted Moses for his lack of reverence before the people. And in verse 12, the scripture says this, because you did not trust me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of Israel, you will not bring this community into the land that I have given them. As a result, Moses was not allowed to cross the Jordan into Canaan. In Exodus 17, it was the people who sinned. In Numbers 20, it was the people and their leaders. These two accounts reveal a common problem in every generation. We are all prone to grumble, to complain, and to put God to a test. If the truth were known, each of us can be demanding of God. While it's not wrong to ask God for help, we do have to be careful about our complaining attitudes. Like Israel in the wilderness, our grumbling proves our lack of confidence in God. Massah and Meribah are historical events, not just places, which expose a deep-seated and recurring tendency to become hard in our heart. And that's when the psalmist says, do not harden your hearts as at Meribah and Massah. The word as indicates it's this kind of attitude which God despises, and he says, you will not enjoy my rest. What then is the message of the psalm? We should worship by our rejoicing and our reverence. And our worship is to be based on God's sovereignty as creator and his sufficiency as our shepherd. It also tells us that worship without obedience is worthless to God. In fact, verse 10 says, it makes God angry. Failure to worship through our obedience causes our hearts to harden, and that is repulsive to God, and it will be destructive to us. Leonard Sweet, in his book written just a year or two ago called Aqua Church, points out that we often like to sing and praise God, but we often don't want to go beyond that. He writes further and says, our pews are occupied by people who want to be moved, but who don't want to move. Let's make sure our worship always leads us to obedience. Let me wrap this up. I want to make two conclusions. First of all, worship is to be primary. The summons from God to worship is fundamental. He's worthy and he longingly seeks people who are committed to worship him in spirit and in truth. Someone has said there are two times to praise and worship God. Number one, when we feel like it. Number two,